take the time to craft everything. Yeah. But it's not quite as having to be on point as when you go into a production.
All right, Bill, we're going live, bud.
All right, cool.
Okay. All right. And then I'm going to go ahead, guys, and share my screen. And then all right. We are here with trumpeter Bill Churchville. Bill, thank you so much for joining us. How are you doing today,
guys? Bob? I'm doing great. Thank you for inviting me, Joe. This is going to be a lot of fun.
Bill, how are things in sunny Southern California there?
Well, we're still practicing our trumpets. We're making sure that trying to keep the chops in shape, man. So when this thing finally opens up, we're ready for just about anything somebody could throw at us, you know. Other than that, we're just, you know, trying to do the social distancing thing and trying to decrease our risks and wearing masks, because they decided that masks is the way to go out here. So we're trying to.
Yeah, I read about that. And, you know, like I said, it's, you know, thank you again for.
I'm right here, man. So. Although I walked in the bank the other day and they looked at me kind of funny, but other than that, you know, no.
Thank you again for taking the time to do this. I know you, even during COVID-19, you're still a busy guy, and you know, I've been a big fan as long as I can say that for a lot of other people. We're a huge fan of yours. I grew up listening to you. I mean, I'm a big, huge fan of Tower of Power. And so Bill, you know, why don't you tell us, Bill, how did you get the horn in your hand? You know, What started the process?
Well, I got a few notes here because you were kind enough to send me some stuff. So I'm going to go through my notes, and that way, you know, we can kind of stay everything on track here.
Sure, man. Yeah.
Well, you know, I was fortunate because I came from a real strong school band program, you know, and I first started playing the horn in New Orleans when I was, you know, between fourth and fifth grade. They started people actually on the instruments.
Yeah.
The summer before fifth grade, you know. And because I was down there in that rich musical culture and everything, I was able to, you know, I heard a lot of brass bands play. I got to go see Al Hurt and Pete Fountain at a very early age, the Mardi Gras parades. And for some reason, trumpet just kind of grabbed a hold of me, man. I loved the fact that trumpet was always the one leading the band, and the trumpet in Dixieland was just very predominant, had the melody. And just, I was drawn to the instrument. I used to, you know, when I was a kid, I'd watch on TV. I'd watch the Tonight Show with Doc Severinsen back, you know, way back in the day.
Steve Allen days, right?
Yeah. And yeah. Also, you know, Lawrence Welk, I wasn't a huge fan of the arrangements, but the musicianship on that band was just flawless, man. Those guys could play anything. Right. So, at a very early age, I really identified with the trumpet. And, when that little period of time between fourth and fifth grade, we had to, the local music store came out and brought all the horns to all the kids in the school and everything to see who would be playing what, you know. And they did a little Dixieland concert right there before they brought the horns out. And they brought the mouthpieces around for everybody to try them. And for some reason, the guy handed me a trumpet mouthpiece and I went zing. And he went, whoa, you're a trumpet player, you know. Congratulations, kid, you're a trumpet player. You know, the next guy's like, oh, they tried to play the clarinet and I couldn't play the clarinet. It's like, congratulations, kid, you're a trombone player, you know. You never had enough trombone players, right? So, but yeah, so I started playing with a little band, and everything was learned by rote. I didn't really learn how to read for about a year there, but I kind of got I really loved the music, and I was really exposed to the culture down there. My family moved around a lot, so by the time I hit junior high school, I'd moved up to Northwest Louisiana near Shreveport. And I had a real good band director up there. And so I started, you know, he had us always playing literature. And then I wound up down in Southwest Louisiana for high school. And I was part of a great marching band down there. The marching band at Barb High School there in Lake Charles was renowned all over the country. They had, you know, Joseph Tate, the band director, was just, you know. And that band we marched in 1976. We marched 265 people on the band of our high school band in Louisiana. 265 people on the field, right? Wow. And that band was also the representative to the Parade of States in Washington D.C. and Philadelphia for the bicentennial. That was a bicentennial year in 76. So I'm telling you how old I am now. The point is, you know, I always excelled in high school and I practiced a lot.
Yeah.
And I became the first chair trumpet player in my sophomore year at that high school. And I stayed first chair throughout my whole time. And because it was such a strong marching program there, I was invited, you know, I went to clinics. I went to, the all district bands, all state mm-hmm. bands. And I got recruited by Louisiana State University, LSU, on a marching scholarship my freshman year at LSU. And I was in the Golden Band from Tigerland, right? The funny thing was, I never really studied trumpet formally. I never took a private lesson until I got to Louisiana State.
Oh, there. Wow.
And on a marching scholarship. So my freshman year there was also, the teacher there was James West, Jim West from Chicago. He was principal trumpet with the Young Men's Symphony in Chicago. And of course I waltzed into his office thinking I was all that and I was on scholarship and I was hot stuff. Right. And I walked into Jim West's office and he was such a calming, cool cat, man. And such a great trumpet player and a great pedagogue too. Mm-hmm. I walked in his office and he had about 15 horns out on stands of various cues. He had various keys. He had E flat D's, D trumpets, B cornets, E flat cornets, piccolo trumpets. And I walked in and went, I'd never seen that many trumpets in one room in my life. And he had a big reel-to-reel recorder in the corner and he had mics set up and everything. And I was like, whoa. And then he sat me down and he put some music in front of me. And I just folded hard, right? It was, you know, he was trying to humble me, yet he was trying not to destroy me, you know?
Right.
And then he reaches over and goes, you know, I think I'll play this one today. And he picked up like some weird keyed trumpet that I'd never seen before and proceeded to play the exercise that he'd handed me and just totally destroyed me. But it was a good check on my ego. Yeah. At that point, I thought I was all that. And the reality was I'd never even started to understand trumpet pedagogy. So Jim, in his wisdom, introduced me to Arbenz and Clark and Mel Broyles and Schlossberg. And all the iconic books that we have to work our way through if we're going to call ourselves a trumpet player in this world, you know. And he also did me a great favor by fixing my broken embouchure. I had drilled my embouchure to the point of all that marching band and all that squeaking out high notes and blowing too hard and just really being a powerhouse player. It had really taken its toll on my embouchure. And I was playing on a 5C Bach mouthpiece.
Ooh.
And double G's and stuff.
Wow.
And So we didn't have access to a lot of equipment in that part of Louisiana back then. You either played a Bach mouthpiece or you played a Schilke mouthpiece, you know, and that was about it. Everybody played a Bach Stradivarius trumpet, great trumpets, you know.
Yeah.
And everybody had a Bach mouthpiece in my band. There was no trumpet teacher, or they had a local university, but it was more conservatory geared toward a conservatory type playing. Yeah. So not anything pop related, anything like that. And I later went to that school, and I'll cover that in a couple minutes here. But I'd been playing too loudly and forcing out high notes, and I was on the wrong equipment. So it really took its toll, you know. And Jim was, you know, I came in there and did the first semester in the marching band. And so that spring, we went into the concert band season at Louisiana State at LSU.
Right.
So I got to, you know, fortunately, Jim didn't mess with my embouchure for the fall semester, because I had to still play first trumpet in the marching band. But that that spring, he took me all the way back down to .0 with the embouchure and moved it basically from here back to centered and back to really set. And he set me back up. And it took about a month for me to really get set on that. But I've used the same embouchure now since then. And so I owe him a great debt of gratitude for that.
So Jim, or I'm sorry, not Jim, Bill, I'm sorry. I got Jim West in my head. So Bill, as a side note to that, I've noticed a lot of young players, and I get this question a lot from a lot of, and you're probably going to get this question too from a lot of young players. Bill, you know, a lot of these young players, they go to Bugle Corps, they go in marching band, like, and they power through things and develop bad habits.
Yeah.
And they, when they go to college and they have to play Baroque, or they have to play classical, and they can't play soft, and they have no control. That's the word I want to use. Can you, just as a quick side note, can you give some advice to somebody who's going through that right now and has to deal with embouchure sets and has to play a marching band because their scholarship depends on it?
Yeah. Well, it's two schools of thought. And I was always under the school of thought that when I started working with Tower, and I got out there in the first few months and doing those shows 6 and 7 nights a week on 3 and 4 week tours, I felt like I could play anything. I had road chops. I could literally play anything all day, all night. But because of the fact that I was playing so strongly and hard and intensely, and it was such an athletic workout every night, I lost a lot of the finer points of my playing.
Yeah.
And it didn't occur to me until I wound up on a recording session and I had to play softly. And I went to play softly, and instead of a note, I got, and I went, whoa, you know, my aperture had opened up so wide that I couldn't bring it back down to play softly. Yeah. So that's when, you know, I started, you know, seeking advice and talked to great players. And the general consensus was, you know, if you're out there and in your work, you're pounding out and playing really hard and really loud, you have to balance that out with soft and with delicate playing. And I went to a Doc Severinsen clinic one time, and I'll never forget this. And Doc, and you know, he's still an amazing trumpet player in his 90s. He's the godfather of all, you know. But he in the beginning of this clinic, this was at a community college I was teaching at out in the South Bay in LA here. He pulls his horn out, he's talking, and he says, yeah, I try to practice. Somebody asked him, you know, you have to play so high and so loud on the dice every night. What do you practice? And he put the horn together, and he played Clark Technical Study number 2, right? He played it quieter and faster than anyone I've ever heard play it in my life. It was flawlessly, and it was so quiet sitting in this auditorium. It was like somebody tearing paper.
Oh, wow.
And it was just flawless and absolutely under total control. And I went, wow. And he said, that's the kind of control it takes to be able to play softly and under control. And he says I do most of my practice softly because I have to do most of my performance loudly. So I have to maintain the suppleness and maintain the flexibility and maintain the instrument. So if you need to play something softly, you can. So practice if your gig is really hard and loud and fast and high, your practice should be opposite of that. It should be slow and low, and you have to balance that out with flexibility exercises. Mouthpiece buzzing, air attacks are real good at getting that aperture set back. Instead of just think air attacks on the mouthpiece, air attacks on the horn. That's a real good way to get that everything settled and everything centered again. It's so easy to let that get out of control.
So, okay, you're in college. You're yeah. say you leave college. Where do you pay your dues, and how did you earn your rep? You know,
boy, that's a, you know, and this has a lot to do with how the world is changing. Everything in the music industry is changing.
Yeah.
And a lot of that is you know, a lot of these days it's changing really fast.
Yeah.
And there are no big bands anymore. Basically not a lot of big bands you can go out and tour with anymore where you can have that finishing school to be talked about, you know,
yeah.
you go to school, you get a degree, you play all this stuff in a college, something like that. Then you get out there and you need something as a bridge between your college days and your professional music days. You got to have like a bridge gig in there to kind of learn. And back in the day, you'd have older players that worked on these bands with you that would school you and yeah. show you things. And if they saw you getting into bad habits, they would correct you and go, you know, you need to play a little differently here because you're going to hurt yourself if you can. There's not a lot of that anymore. You're kind of thrown to the wolves now. That's the bad part. The good part is because of technology now, you know, anybody can get their music in front of a million people if they happen to get a popular YouTube video or a popular Instagram, you know, so you right. have the ability to get your music out there to many more people that you never had when I was coming up. Because right. when I was coming up, either you did an album, to do an album yourself was very expensive.
Yeah.
And even then, if you did an album, you had to, you know, you had to promote it on radio, you had to promote it through other ways because there was no real internet for you to access all these things. And if you were a solo artist or whatever, if you didn't have a deal with a major recording label, record label, you know, your record was never really heard other than by your circle of friends, you know?
Right.
And so in that way, the technology has made it much better for people to get their music out there.
Right.
You know, but it's also changed the finishing school now. Everybody, right. the finishing school now, instead of going on the road with Count Basie or going on the road with Tower of Power or going on the road with, yeah. you know, Glenn Miller or any number of the big bands, now the finishing school seems to be play something in your basement and throw it up on YouTube and see if everybody likes it.
Yeah, pretty much.
So the danger with that is we get this idea that you know, people just put their stuff up there, and there's a lot of it's good. A lot of it is really terrible.
Yeah.
And a lot of it, you know, is embarrassing. And I look at it and go, wow, they really put that up, you know. But then I think, well, maybe they think that's okay. Maybe that's their point of reference for what a professional should sound like. You know?
Right.
But you notice right now I'm talking through a professional microphone. And I'm not using the tiny little microphone on my iPhone or on my computer yeah. here because, you know, it makes a difference to having right. a microphone the size of a pinhead and an expensive cardioid condenser mic. It's the difference between sounding big and controlled and very tiny and tinny.
Right.
So, you know, I'm not knocking the whole YouTube generation. Yeah. Man. Guys continue to put some great stuff out there because I see some amazing things, players yeah. and stuff. But it's not all about just playing high notes on the internet, man. That's not going to really get you a gig, you know?
Yeah. And so, I mean, you were just touching on this. A lot of people don't understand that, okay, you have to pay your dues somehow.
Yeah.
Because people have to trust you with the small things in order to trust you with the big things.
Yeah, that's very true.
You know? And then, so, you know, I noticed a lot of guys coming out of college, you know, say, oh, well, or even in college, well, my time is worth something. And it's like, no, man, look at the reason why you don't get paid the Bill Churchville money is because Bill has proven himself over 25, 30 years to, you know, so they, like you said, they don't have the finishing school. So if you could, can you tell us, okay, so you're working, what town were you working, if you don't mind me asking, when you were just getting started?
Well, I was in Lake Charles, Louisiana, Southwest Louisiana, before I went in the Army band.
Yeah.
I moved to Houston, played in Houston for a couple of years, went to University of Houston, got to know some great musicians in Houston, joined the union, I was very young. I was probably 19, 20 years old, 20, 21. And I got known around Houston as a first trumpet player, and they hired me on some of the big bands and stuff. And so I got to do some work at 19, 20, 20 years old, playing first trumpet in a big band in Houston. At that point, this was early 1980s, and the oil crunch hit, the oil crisis hit, and all the local hotels. I was working the hotel circuit, Holiday Inns, all these. We had a 5-6 piece band. We were doing, you know, what was considered, you know, what would be considered smooth jazz now. It was more like popular music redone in instrumental styles. And we did a lot of, you know, Crusaders, and we had a really funky, cool soul band. But overnight, all that work disappeared in Houston. So I picked up and moved from Southwest Louisiana to Houston because I realized that I had to be in a bigger town in order to get enough work to survive, you know?
Yeah.
And so when that happened, all the music was gone. I had bills to pay, and I was like, well, I want to play my horn. What the heck do I do? So I got this, I'm thinking, wow, man, I'd seen a couple of guys in like Charles that was stationed at Fort Polk Army Band. Let me give the Army Band a try, you know, and the military bands. You know, there's some great military bands out there.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, wow, I want to go in there. I want to go to Washington, D.C. and play in one of the top military bands.
Yeah.
And at that time, you know, you had to go through one of the line bands first. So I joined, went in, volunteer, and went to basic training. They didn't send me to a real fun, cool, I'm going to be in the Army band basic training. Yeah. They sent me to Fort Jackson, South Carolina, and sent me to infantry basic training. So, boy, they made a man out of me real fast.
Yeah.
And I came out of there and wound up at the School of Music in Norfolk, Virginia for the Army, Navy, Marine Corps. And that's normally a 6-month school. And I thought, you know, I got there and I was thinking, you know, I wasn't real happy there. I after that traumatic experience of boot camp, I was going, you know, this was back in old boot camp. Now boot camp's totally different. So it's a different animal now. But I think, you know, so I wound up advancing out of that school in 6 weeks because I was able to play everything and learn everything I needed to know there and do an advancing audition and advance out of there. So I wound up, my first Army band was in Indianapolis, and I learned how to play the trumpet for 10 hours a day because we were always playing drums, man. We'd be marching band. We had a stage band. We had jazz combos. We had a concert band that rehearsed every day, did a concert every Thursday, you know, so it was just an immersive playing experience. Yeah. I played and tons of marches, which are great for articulation and great for your fingers and everything like that. Plus we got to play jazz. It was, you know, it was a bit of the drag was you had to do the military duties and stuff like that and deal with the military hierarchy and stuff. But the music was great. And I worked with I met a lot of lifelong friends there, guys that 35 years later have now ascended to the pinnacle of the music business in the military. They were in Washington D.C. band there and the premier band in Washington D.C. Army band. Yeah. And but the second half of my enlistment, I was stationed in Panama, in Central America, in the 79th Army band. And the cool thing about that place was we had a salsa band down there. I'd never played I'd never played salsa before, right?
Right.
So I'm a big band player. All of a sudden I'm hit with salsa, and the, you know, the rhythms are totally opposite of what you would think, but trying to read big band. I didn't understand the clave thing. You know, we had two or three Puerto Rican guys that played all the LP and the conguero and the bells and the timbales and stuff. These guys were salsa masters. Right.
Right.
So I learned how to play salsa, and I got to see a lot of the world as a very young man, because that band toured all over Central and South America. We were everywhere from Brazil to Chile to Guatemala to Costa Rica to Panama to Colombia to Venezuela to, you know, to Argentina to Brazil to Bolivia to, you know, I got to see everything south of Mexico basically.
Yeah.
And so I got to tour a lot and realize that touring is a whole different world, man. It's not only does your music have to be together, but your health has got to be together. Your head's got to be together. You got to be on you got to be on the clock. You got to know what you're doing. You know, the military helped me that a lot. It taught me a lot about personal discipline, a lot about just discipline in general, how to be disciplined. And I made much better grades in college when I got out of the Army than before I went in. I got out of the service.
Discipline, right? Yeah.
I was like, dude, I don't want to do that anymore. When I got down to Panama, it was right before they went in to get Manuel Noriega. So they were gearing up for a war down there, and they changed a lot of our training. We had to do a lot of soldiering, doing a lot of jungle training and combat training. And I decided that I liked entertaining people a lot more than learning how to kill people. I said, I'm done with this. You know, it's been great, guys. Thank you for my experience. And I came back. The only place I knew to come back to was Southwest Louisiana, where my mother lived at the time. And I went to work on my undergrad degree at McNeese State University in Lake Charles. And at the time, they had a really good music program there. And I got to meet Dr. Michael Ewald. Now, yeah. Dr. Michael Ewald was a renowned trumpet teacher. He had earned his Doctor of Musical Arts degree from USC, Southern California, in the 1970s. So his approach to pedagogy was decidedly West Coast.
Right.
But Jim West, when he came down to LSU, he'd come out of Chicago. So he was out of the Chickowitz out of Hurstith, that school. Yeah. And nothing bad about that, of course, but this was a whole different approach for me. The West Coast school with Jimmy Stamp, Pappy Mitchell, Thomas Stevens, you know, Tony Plove, you know, Bill Bing, all these guys, you know, and the West Coast take on pedagogy just seemed to resonate more with the way I like to play the horn, because, you know, the West Coast thing was a little more commercial oriented. The sound was a little more lively and not as big and Germanic, German like. It was a little, you know, it was just a lighter sound. And you know, I kind of, you know, and I started resonating with that, you know. And so Mike Ewald had studied personally with Jimmy Stamp.
Oh, wow.
He was a first generation Stamp student. And when I got out of the Army and got back to McNeese there, my chops were a wreck, man. I'd been like the featured soloist with all these bands, and I was having to play Maynard tunes every night, screaming high stuff, and you know, without the proper pedagogy to play that, I was doing damage on my face. So I never had any cuts, so I was lucky where I'd ever cut.
Yeah.
But I was really, you know, I'd really done a number on my chops. And you know, Mike sat me down, showed me how to practice the mouthpiece, showed me the Jimmy Stamp method, and got me into practicing that type of a conservatory mindset, pedagogical mindset. And that really changed the game for me, man, because it got me back in shape, got me on better equipment, and got me more, you know, more thinking about good pedagogy.
Right.
And that's something I can't stress enough to young players. You got to get your pedagogy together, because later on in life, you don't realize it now, but you get in your 40s and 50s, and you have a hernia, or you have an undulation, or you have a problem with your teeth, or you have any kind of problems with your body, and you're playing the trumpet, especially if you're playing it professionally, you better have good pedagogy to fall back on.
Right.
Don't have that pedagogy, you're not going to be able to recover from that injury or that stuff, because you're not going to know what to do. And I see that with natural players, and I'm not going to mention any names, but there's a great trumpet player out here that I worked with for years. If I said his name, you would know him. He's a household name.
Yeah.
And he's, when this cat is on, nobody can touch this guy. He's an amazing trumpet player. He's made all these great records. And I toured with him for a while. And the thing is, when he started having problems later on in life with his teeth and with his embouchure and things, he didn't have the pedagogy there to fix that, or to understand how to work your way through that, or a case of Bell's palsy or anything like that.
Oh, wow, yeah.
If you have anything pop up on your horizon as a player, you better have good pedagogy to fall back on, because you're going to have to be able to rebuild yourself after you recover from this thing, you know?
Yeah. So I'm just going to go to it, buddy.
Go for it.
I got a lot of people asking, tell us about TOP. How did you get the gig? What is the gig like? What was your first night like? You know, and how'd you get the gig?
Right.
Yeah. So tell us about your TOP days.
Okay. Let me kind of just give you a real quick segue from Louisiana to Southern California.
Right.
I won a Downbeat College Jazz Soloist Award in 1987, and I was looking for somewhere to go for graduate school. I was looking at either New York, I was looking at Chicago, I was looking at LA, because I realized at that time, if I was going to make a living in the music industry as a instrumental musician, as a solo trumpet player, as a big band, whatever, a lead trumpet player, I was going to have to go where the work is. I can't expect the work to come to me.
Right.
Now that's changed a little bit with the internet and with the YouTube and the different types of online platforms we have now with social media. But at that time, and even today, if you're going to make it in the industry, you got to go where the industry is. The industry is not going to come to you unless you are just the most amazing talent on the planet, Jason Collier level talent.
Right.
You know, that's the only way that's going to come to you. You have to go to it. Right. So I won the Downbeat Award. That got me an interview with Dr. Tom Mason. He was director of jazz studies at USC. And Tom had recently graduated as former trumpet master student, and they had an opening. So through auditioning and through working that, I got out to Los Angeles in the late 1980s to pursue a master's degree in music from USC. I was a teaching assistantship. I had a scholarship. Wow. Playing with all these guys. I studied with Bobby Shue. I studied with John Thomas and learned everything about the Basie style. John's
great. Oh, John's amazing, man. Yeah.
Man, that cat knows more about playing Basie than anybody alive.
Yeah.
I learned so much about big band first trumpet playing with John. And I studied with him for a year. Next year, I got to study with Bobby Shue because Bobby was one of the adjunct guys with the school. And Bobby, he's been called the Yoda of the trumpet for good reason.
Yeah.
Bobby is the biggest trumpet guru alive today. So many cats owe their career to Bobby, and I do too. Yeah. He taught me how to breathe properly on the instrument. I was not really taking a full breath. I was not really controlling my airflow. And he also gave me the greatest gift of my career. He helped me find the right mouthpiece for high compression playing. And he brought me through an exhaustive mouthpiece search over the course of a year with lessons with him, put me through all these different mouthpieces until I finally hit on a combination that just worked for my chops and my airflow and my horn and my philosophy. And I still use that model to this day, that model mouthpiece. Now, the thing about Tower, you know, breaking into the business, you know, a colleague a year ahead of me at graduate school at USC gave me a real great piece of advice. He said about LA, mm-hmm. He says, if you're not willing to give it 5 hard years of paying dues in the trenches, maybe even working at Trader Joe's or working at Ralph's or grocery store, so you can play your gigs on a weekend. If you're not willing to give it 5 hard years, finish your degree and go back where you came from, because you're not going to be able to break into this town for anything less than 5 years. Yeah. And in 5 years, the lucky ones are just breaking in at that point, you know?
That's so, the term lucky.
Dude, this is one of the most competitive musical environments in the world.
Yeah.
You know? And you got the film guys, you got the, you know, you got all the guys that play commercial music. You got the recording guys. There's probably 100 trumpet players in this town that are just absolutely top rate, phenomenal players. You just haven't heard all their names.
Yeah.
You know, you've heard a few of the names and you might see a few of the names on TV, but you know, that's a pretty stiff competition, man. And how are you going to stand out among guys like that? So back in the day, the only way to do that, I got out of school. I started making a bunch of the union rehearsal bands. You go down and play with all these rehearsal bands. Cats sit next to you, hear you play. They recommend you for work. You meet guys, you meet other people. You meet people, you know, musical directors for these things. Come and hear these bands. All of a sudden, bam, your phone starts ringing. You know, it takes, and it's not overnight. It's something that takes years. You start getting called a sub for more established players. I started making inroads into the pop commercial session scene because I made friends with some older players that knew me and knew that I played really well in tune and I was a good solid second trumpet player.
Yeah.
I could match style with anybody playing first. I could match their pitch. I could match all their inflections. And guys recognized that and they started calling me. And the most important thing, I didn't try to steal their clients and I kept my mouth shut.
Amen.
And I played well.
I
didn't try to talk to the producer. I didn't try to talk to the engineer. I showed up. I smiled. I sat down. I played well and I kept my mouth shut.
Yeah.
You know?
That's very important.
Yeah. So I'm still leading up to the Tower thing, guys. Hold on. It's a little bit of a progression here. Yeah. But at that point, I was starting to do some pretty good sessions. I did a couple sessions for Elton John. I did a couple sessions with Aaron Neville. So I'd already been on a couple platinum albums by the time the Tower started coming on the horizon.
Yeah. You know?
But I kept hearing in Los Angeles at that time, that, you know, I was at the stage of my career where I was hearing about, oh, did you hear about so-and-so? He got the such-and-such gig. And I was like, no, I didn't hear about that. Oh, but yeah, and so-and-so got this gig. And I was like, wow, man, all these guys are getting all these great gigs.
Yeah.
How come I'm not hearing about this stuff? And I started asking myself, why am I not hearing about these gigs before somebody else gets them?
Right.
You know? So I said, I started asking myself, I said, who do I need to know? Which is the empowering question. Yeah. Why aren't I getting called for these gigs? That's the disempowering question.
Right, right.
The empowering question is, who do I need to know to find out about these gigs before they happen? So I can have a chance of scoring one of these gigs, right?
Yeah.
Well, the people you need to get to know are musical directors, producers, you know, musical directors are usually keyboard players, sometimes drummers, sometimes guitar players that are the nerve center, usually working directly with an artist. That's the musical director. That's the guy that is the chain of command between the band and the artist. If you're backing Tom Jones, if you're backing Rihanna, if you're backing Prince, there's a musical director there that is Prince's guy or Rihanna's guy, and he's the one that runs the show. You have to work for him, so you have to endear yourself to him, and you've got to get to know the guy. So when they do have an opening, he thinks about you. you know, and not his other 300 people he knows that can play the stuff and out of the book because he's been in town a long time. Right.
Right.
So yeah, I asked myself, you know, where do guys like that hang out? You know, and I started thinking clubs, you know, okay, they hang out in clubs because they want to hear bands too. And they want to hear great musicians. So I started doing, started playing in clubs. I found a friend of mine, just happens to be Sean Holt, the guy that we worked on the Lopez Tonight Show with. Wow. Sean and I, both being from Louisiana, wound up at USC about the same time. We put together a little small two-man horn section, and I'd go out and we'd hear all these bands in town, and I'd make notes of what they were playing, and I'd go back to the house and scribble out charts. We'd come back the next week, and I had charts for five or six of their songs. We'd go up on, I'd pull the guy off stage, you know, on his break and go, hey, man, why don't you let us sit in with your band? I was here last week. I have charts, horn charts for five of your songs, man. Let us play some songs. And the guy would be like, whoa, I can't believe you do that.
Yeah.
And then they come back from break. They bring us up on stage. We'd basically ambush them and we'd blow the roof off the place. Right?
Right.
And the artist is going, wow, man, I can't believe you guys did this. The club is going, wow, this is great. You know, and there's musical directors sitting out there, guys that are producers, guys that are engineers that are hearing us walk in and just raise the overall level of intensity in this club by tenfold. That's when you're, you know, that's when you got guys on the break kind of, hey man, give me your card. I got something I want to record, man. Yeah. Can you, you do any recording? You do any recording work? Or, hey, you want to play? That's when your phone starts ringing. When people start talking about you outside of your circle, your small little circle here, when people start talking about you on the outer circles, that's when your phone starts ringing this bit. So anyway, back to Tower. Okay. Fast forward a couple years. I was playing with a lot of bands in Club A. Clubs in LA. I was making a living working in casual bands, club date bands in New York, wedding bands, corporate bands, private parties. Good way to make a living when you're, you know, when you're wanting to play music full time. You don't want to have to get a damn day job, you know. But so as far as Tower, one of my friends I knew from USC who worked with the drum line at the USC marching band, his name's George Barrett. He's also the CEO of Innovative Percussion, the company that makes all the mallets and all the stuff. Great guy. His wife was a friend of my ex-wife. She was also a percussion major at USC. So I met George. George was the artist rep for Remo Drums at the time.
Yeah.
It was probably 1990, 1991, right about the time I was graduating at SC.
Yeah.
Anyway, one of Remo's drum artists at the time was Russ McKinnon. And Russ was the drummer for Tower then, right? So George knew Russ. He knew that I really dug Tower. And so I started hanging with George. George would take me to drum corps events where Russ was being there working with Remo and as an endorsing artist and talking to these young drum corps guys. And then we'd see a drum corps show. So through George, I got to meet Russ. And when I met Russ, I didn't walk up to Russ and go, hey man, I want to play in your band. Oh my God. You know, I went up there and went, hey man, how are you? Wow. Nice to meet you. I love your work with Tower. And after then everything was cool, you know, and we talked and Russ and I kind of got to know each other over time, you know. And then, you know, fast forward, you know, Russ, you know, so I kind of struck up a cool relationship, a friendship with Russ. It wasn't like I'd call him every day, but every now and then I just kind of touch base with him because that's what you want to do when you find gigs that you think that you're perfect for. Find somebody in that organization, somebody in that circle of people and endear yourself to one of those people and try to get a little bit of information out of this, right? So George, my buddy George Barrett, decided, he also invited me to tag along to a session when Tower was recording the Monster on the Leash album. This was at Bill Schnee's studio in North Hollywood.
Yeah.
And they were just doing rhythm tracks that day. So it was Rocco, it was Russ, Rocco, and Carmen Grillo on guitar, Nick Milo, I think, on keyboards on that record. So the horn players weren't there. Emilio was there, of course, because Emilio Castillo was producing the record.
Yeah.
Greg Adams was there because Greg was doing the charts for the record because Greg always did the charts for the record. And he had his score there. So George brings me in, you know, Russ waves. Hey, Russ, how are you? I say, hey, Russ, good to see you, man. So everybody kind of saw me interact with Russ. I go stand in the back of the studio booth there, you know, behind the recording engineers, behind all the principals that are working in the nerve center of the studio. Those guys are out in the main part of the studio. The artists are recording and I'm sitting back there. And what do you think I'm doing? I have my mouth closed. I'm not saying a word. I'm a fly on the wall, right? Cause I don't, you know, this ain't about me. Nobody knows who I am. Nobody cares who I am. I'm there to get as much information as I can and to make myself memorable to them, but not annoy them in any way, right?
Right.
So I saw Greg was working on his charts. He kept working on his thing. I saw Emilio was producing the band. Those guys were playing their tails off, you know. And I'm sitting in the back of the booth. I keep my mouth shut and I'm observing everything. Mm-hmm. After a few takes, the guys take a break. You know, I walk up and introduce myself to Greg. I'd actually met him in a club in New Orleans a couple of years before that when I saw the band play live at Jimmy's in New Orleans after one of the Huey Lewis Superdome hits. And Greg didn't remember me. I didn't think he would. But I said, hey, Greg, I actually met you before in New Orleans. And he was like, oh, yeah, right, right. And I said, he didn't know I was a trumpet player. And I said, hey, man, can you show me your chart there? And he's like, well, yeah, man. I said, what are you doing? And he started showing me his score.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at his score. And all of a sudden, you know, I'm an arranger, too. At this point, I'm a budding arranger. But all of a sudden, it started making sense to me, these great voicings that Greg would put together. That really made the band sound great. That horn section, world class, right? I started looking at the way Greg wrote for that band. I'm like, oh man, all of a sudden it started making sense. So I just said, hey man, I'm a big fan of your writing. I said, man, cool. And then I stepped back in the back and shut my mouth again, right? So fast forward, you know, I felt like I was looking at the Holy Grail there, you know?
Right.
I finally saw the harmony writing for the TOP horns.
Yeah.
But I didn't talk about me. I let them talk about themselves, you know. So fast forward a couple of years, I get a call from Russ telling me, hey man, Lee Thornburg and Greg Adams are going to be leaving the band. And we're looking for a couple of trumpet players. That's when I figured out, it all clicked in my head. Wow, that's how you find out about the gig before somebody else tells you that somebody else got the so-and-so gig.
Right. Get
somebody on the inside, right? So he says, we're going to be doing auditions. Put me together a promo packet of your work with your, you know, basically back then a promo packet was a headshot and a cassette tape, or, you know, this is before CDs.
Yeah.
Listen to me. Before CDs were popular to make your own CD
right
out there, but a cassette tape of your, some of your performances and a bio, one sheet bio of everything, everybody you played with.
Yeah.
They think, you put it together, bam, bam, you deliver it, you know. So they have something to look at, something to listen to, and in a list of your accomplishments, right? So, you know, I got it together, sent it out as quickly as I could.
Oh.
You know, so sure enough, about a week or two later, you know, my phone rings, and it's their manager going, hi, Bill, my name is Michelle Zarin. I'm managing for Tower, and we're having an audition at the studios in Burbank. It's a rehearsal studio there called Center Staging, right?
No.
We got a room for Center Staging for the day. You'll be your audition time will be 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Da, 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 da. So show up, you know, it's going to be cool. It's going to be relaxed. Just show up prepared to play.
Yeah.
Right? So this is about a week or two before the thing, you know? And so, you know, as soon as they call me with this information, the first thing I did not do was call any of my friends and tell them that this had happened. I didn't want any other trumpet player in town to hear about this.
Exactly.
You do not want to say anything to anybody, because if any of the big fish out there would have got wind of this,
they would have been at that rehearsal.
They would have been. Not only that, they would have been calling through their contacts around back channels trying to cut you off.
Right. Right.
Steal that gig. Right. Because anytime you've got a plum gig like that out there, there are cats that are standing in line with their knives waiting to, you know, cut their so the first rule is don't tell a soul. You know?
Keep your mouth shut.
Keep your mouth shut. That seems to be a unifying theme here.
Exactly.
Right. So I sat down and made a list. I'd seen Tower play live at the LA County Fair. I'd seen them play at the Hollywood Bowl, a couple other places. And I sat down and wrote down every song I'd ever heard them play live. Right. I called my friend George. George knew that the audition was, I swore him to secrecy too.
Yeah.
I said, look, Russ, call me on this. You're not to tell a soul. I don't give a darn. Right.
No.
I said, but give me a list of your top 10 tunes you've heard Tower play over the last 5 years.
No.
He gave me a list of the tunes that he had heard them play too. Right. So now I had a list of about 20 songs that I had heard Tower play live. Right. So I went through my collection of all the CDs at the time. I had everything they'd ever done, right? Between albums and between cassette tapes. And I put together, basically started transcribing. I transcribed all 20 of those songs, the first trumpet part of all 20 of those songs, right? I had a week to prepare.
Did you know you were auditioning for first trumpet?
I didn't care. Okay. I knew that I better be able to play first trumpet, because you always assume that you have to go in and cover the hardest part. You never leave it to chance.
Okay.
And I was prepared to play the first part or the second part. I just wanted the shot on the band. Right.
Right.
So I studied the first parts and I sat and transcribed through them, and every single thing I transcribed articulations. And I really spent a lot of time on that. Now, after I got that done, after a couple of days of just solid transcribing, I sat down with the horn, put the recordings on, and started playing along with the recordings on everything I'd transcribed, right? All the studio recordings, making sure that my articulations were right on what they were doing. Attacks were together, swells were together, releases were together, falls were perfectly clean together. I concentrated on every aspect of their musical performance on the studio record, right? And I had some of the live stuff too from the Live and Living Color record at that time. So I transcribed first trumpet part on every song. I played along with the recordings. I copped the style. I had it down cold. I said, I'm prepared for this thing. I really know that I'm going to be confident. So the day of the audition, you know, I showed up confident. I could probably play anything they could throw at me musically.
Yeah.
There were about 10 other trumpet players standing around in the hallway of the rehearsal studio. You know, they were all profiling and everything. You know, yeah. I knew quite a few of the guys. I knew them. They looked at me. I looked at them, you know, and they were kind of, you know, this was the hallway outside of the actual room.
Right.
So I kind of knew that they were not going to be my competition, because I'd played with a lot of those guys, and I didn't think that they were up at the level that I had witnessed the band play at. And right. I knew they weren't as prepared as I was, because I'm an old Boy Scout, man. I was an Eagle Scout. Yeah. Be prepared. That's
exactly.
That's always been my motto. Yeah. Be over prepared, right? So I knew that they knew these guys weren't going to be a problem, but there was this one cat that I had known that Michelle had told me about, their manager. This guy had flown in from New York for the audition.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, man, if this guy is willing to fly in from New York, get a hotel room, pay for that ticket, and show up to audition for this gig, he is going to be loaded for bear.
Yeah.
He is going to really have his stuff together.
Yeah.
And as soon as I saw this cat, I knew he was my main competition, and he knew that I was his competition. So we kind of square off. We're looking at each other, and I'm thinking, you know, how am I going to handle this? Because I don't want to be like the typical guy and go over and try to vibe him and mess with his concentration.
Yeah.
Because that's not, I've never been about, there's a lot of trumpet players, especially back then in LA, they were about that. They would try to mess, they'd get on a band with you or a big band. They try to mess with your concentration and try to get you to make a mistake. And they try to get you to just doubt. It was just all part of this mind screwing, right? With you, right? I didn't want to do that with this guy. You know, I just walked over and went, hey man, my name is Bill. What's your name? He goes, my name is Barry Danilia.
Oh, Barry.
I said, how are you, Barry, man? What a pleasure to meet you, man. You came all the way out here from New York. Yeah. And I said, well, man, good luck. And he goes, good luck to you too. And I said, who have you played with? He says, oh, Eddie Palmieri. And he started naming off all these bands. And I'm like, whoa, this guy's going to carve me up in this thing. I'm thinking he's going to dice me so hard. But I didn't let it affect my confidence, because I knew I had the music down. I'd shedded the stuff. I'd transcribed the stuff, you know. So we talked for a few minutes, and that was really the beginning of a beautiful friendship, because Barry and I went on to play with the band for 3 years after that, till after he left the band. You know, he left the band before I did. But let me tell you a little bit about the audition, because this was one of the coolest things ever. So I knew I had the music down cold. I'd rehearsed all this stuff. I transcribed it. I'd been shedding it at the house. I knew that I could play the stuffing out of stuff, right? So what do you think? When I walked in the audition, what do you think I did? I played it totally cool. I didn't let those guys know that I had spent a second working on their music. I was not overconfident. I was totally cool. I didn't want to telegraph that I'd spent any time preparing or transcribing the music or any of that stuff. I just walked in and said, hi guys, how you doing? Emilio, it's a pleasure to be here. So Mimi asked me a few questions. You know, Russ is like, hey, Russ, how are you? He's like, hey, man. So it was just me and Lee Thornburg. Greg wasn't there at the time. So Lee and I were going to play, you know, they pulled me in. Standby Lee, they had the charts there on the stand. And I acted like that this was the first time I'd ever seen the charts. I'm looking through the charts and I'm okay, and taking the pencil and, you know, acting like it's the first time I've ever seen the music, or even the first time I've ever heard the music, right?
Right.
Right. So
right.
I'm Mr. Cool.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm sitting there, you know, and I got the horn and everything. And they go, well, let's play, you know, A Little Knowledge Is a Dangerous Thing, you know. Bill, why don't you play a second? Okay, sure, fine. They counted off. little knowledge is a danger. We finished that, and Amelia was like, wow, that was pretty good, man. That was pretty good. You know, and they played a couple more from that Monster on a Leash record, you know. And then he goes, well, let's do You're Still a Young Man, you know. And he's down in the section. I'm standing there next to Lee. And I said, well, Lee, you want to play first on this? And Lee goes, no, Bill, why don't you play first on this? And I said, okay. But Amelia didn't hear that. Nobody else in the band heard that. I was just talking to Lee. And I'd known Lee for a couple of years. And,
he's a beautiful cat, man.
He's a total beautiful cat. And he gave me some of my first breaks in L.A. working on some outstanding record. So I have nothing but total respect for him. So Mimi counts the song off. We go into You're Still a Young Man. I'm playing first trumpet and I'm pasting this thing because I've played it 50 times in the last week, right? I'm saying I'm going to be ready, loaded for bear. I paste this thing to the wall, you know, and we finish the introduction. I'm hanging on that high E, you know, and Mimi stops the band and goes, okay, guys, let's play it again. This time, Bill, you play lead. And Lee looks at Amelia and goes, Mimi, Bill was playing lead. And Amelia just goes, oh.
Audition's over.
Yeah, that's basically, that was it. That was, the audition was over at that point, you know. The funny thing about it, you know, through the way it worked, they needed to hire two trumpets and they were still rotating a couple other guys through the band. So Barry actually, I won the audition that day, but because of the things worked out with prior commitments on my end of things, I couldn't be available immediately. So Barry actually went out with them for about another month or so. And I started working with them in July of that year, you know, so Barry had been out with them with a couple of other trumpet players that, you know, I'm not going to talk smack about any cats out there, but the guys that Barry was having to play with on the band during that period of time were not of the caliber that they had to be to play that music. So Barry was having to play all the lead and he was having to play all the jazz. And the other guy was chops. The other two or three guys that were rotating through the band at that time were having major chop problems on the gig, because this, if you have any chop problems, this gig will pull them out of you. Right.
So Bill, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
A lot of people, we're almost at, oh gosh, we only got 10 minutes.
Man, shoot, I'm so sorry.
I'm so sorry, Bill. I mean, everything's just what you say. I'm sucking it all in. So, is it okay if we got questions? Is it okay if we go like 10 minutes over? Is that
sure? Cool? I don't have, you have all the time in the world. We can go half an hour over.
You're a beautiful man, Bill. Thank you.
I'm getting the sip of my Pellegrino here, and I'll be right with you.
So, Bill, a lot of the, and we were talking about this earlier, a lot of the misconceptions with people is, oh, I played these charts in wedding bands or in corporate bands. So it's when you actually play with the real band, it's a totally different experience. Now, one of the things I've noticed is that, you know, you were talking, can you tell people what the book is like chop wise? And can you tell them what your first night was like?
Yeah. There's a difference between studio chops and live performance touring chops,
right?
Night and day. For a band like Tower, the book is heavily musical. You got to be able to play a lot of different styles. You got to be able to play, you know, flawless attacks, flawless. You got to be able to play with the rest of this band. This rhythm section is amazingly tight. The horn section is world-class tight. So every articulation has got to be phrased exactly like everybody else in the group, you know? And that's a world-class band. Phrasing, articulation, feel, soul, musicality, dynamics, all the elements of the highest level of musical performance every night.
Every night.
We would go out and do 21 straight days in Europe. We do 19 shows in 21 days in 20 different cities. And the 2 days we had off were travel days, you know? So that's keeping your chops up to a level of, you know, it's not only just showing up and playing the gig, it's the other 23 hours of the day when you're traveling by train, plane, bus, and you're wondering about, when am I going to be able to practice? When am I going to be able to buzz my mouthpiece? Because guys on a bus don't want to hear you practice. They don't want to buzz your mouthpiece. But the thing about this gig that's so, you know, you have to be on top of your endurance. And I had a workout that I did to prepare for this show, this gig, that I would start preparing 2 weeks early before a tour. I'd play down the show once a day, just to make sure I still had it. If we had a couple of weeks off between tours, I'd take a week or two before we went back out and start playing the show again. And I would set my studio up in the house with the stand, with the, you know, the microphone there, like it is on the stage. I would have my horns, both of my horns that I played. I'd have, you know, it was just like recreating the show, the stage at the show. I'd play one of the live one of the live tapes. We recorded a live show. We recorded a lot of our shows. So we would have tapes to practice along with, and I'd play through an entire show every day leading up to the tour. Now, if it was going to be an especially grueling tour, which most of them were,
yeah,
I'd play that show twice a day, 3 or 4 days before we left on tour. Because usually, yeah, I'd play the show down in the afternoon and then in the evening, top to bottom, all the solos, every single song, you know, just so I'd have the endurance to play it, right?
Yeah.
Because if you wait till the day before you have to fly out for one of these tours to get your stuff together, you're done. Because let me tell you what's going to happen. You're going to be up real early in the morning going to Los Angeles airport. You're going to get on a plane. You're going to fly 14 hours to Europe. You're going to get off that plane in Europe. You're going to get on a bus. You're going to drive 400 miles and you're going to wind up in some hotel that night. That's 36 hours you don't have on your horn.
Yeah.
And then the next day you're going to get up, go straight to a venue, do a sound check and play a big show. And if you've got 38, 40 hours of not playing your horn because you've been in transit and you haven't spent the week or 2 weeks before getting your endurance together, you're not going to make it, man. You might do one or two shows, but by that third show, your chops are going to be hamburger. You're going to be hurting, man.
That's so invaluable. I mean, that's so, a lot of people don't talk about that, Bill, because a lot of people don't know what it's like. I've heard people talk about, you know, getting killed on shows because, you know, they're not prepared like you did.
No etude book, no stamp exercise, no Clark technical stuff is going to prepare you for that.
Yeah.
It's just, and I still use that formula today when I go out with Blood, Sweat, and Tears. I've probably been working on and off with them for 15 years. And I do an occasional tour for them. Not so much anymore, but for a while there. In 2017, I went and did a month in Australia with them. I have to start working the week before I fly out. I'm playing down the show top to bottom, playing every tune, every cue, everything. And the first couple times, you know, you might make it halfway through the show and go, ugh, I'm going to rest.
Yeah.
You know? The next day you pick it up, you push it a little further till you have to rest. By the third or fourth day, you're playing the entire show without a problem. You know, then by the fifth, sixth, seventh day before you leave, you're doing two shows a day so that you know you have the endurance to be able to last. And here's the thing that a lot of cats don't realize. When you're playing with a band like that, you walk out on the stage, you got 10,000 people in that audience going,
yeah,
stage, man, your adrenaline's on 12. If you walk out there and pick the horn up with that adrenaline and go, wah, like you want to, you're going to last about 5 minutes. Then you're going to have 2 more hours to play that horn where you're going to be playing on your teeth.
Wow.
So you got to learn to control that adrenaline. It's just like a boxer in the boxing ring, man. Yeah. You get in the ring with a boxer and you start getting hit and your adrenaline comes in, you're going to get beat down. You got to control that urge to overplay, you know, because it's a long show.
Yeah.
And the Tower show, that first encore is always, you're still a young man.
Always.
That thing is waiting for you. If you have a 2 hour set. And if you burn it all out 30 minutes into the show, at the end of that 120 minutes, when you got to walk off stage for 30 seconds and walk back out and play young man, you're toast.
Oh, yeah.
You mess that up, you won't be employed very long in that band.
Yeah, I was going to say.
That's their big song, you know? Yeah.
I was going to ask you too, you know, when you play in a two trumpet book like that,
yeah,
you know, how important is it to have the right second guy? You know what I mean?
Well, it's totally valuable. You know? Yeah. And the thing about Barry, you know, that Barry and I worked together, you know, and we kind of on the sly realized that was a whole lot for one guy to do. And yeah. And Mick Gillette was able to do it. I think Mike Bogart was able to do it.
Yeah.
And, but it was, you know, with, if you only did one or two shows a week, it wouldn't be a problem. Doing 6, 7, 8, 9 shows a week,
wow,
2 show days and stuff. That's, you know, that band is really hard on first trumpet players and hard on vocalists to sing that many shows in a row. That's so rare. So Barry and I worked out a system where we kind of, we split up some of the lead stuff, you know, We didn't really tell the rest of the guys as we didn't want to deal with that, but we kind of, you know, but we figured out, because Barry and I hung a lot. We talked about Trumpet a lot, pedagogy, and Barry has good, solid pedagogy too. He went to Berkeley, went, he studied with a lot of great players in New York. I realized that his forte up high was the key of E natural, which is our F sharp on the horn. Anything in that key of F sharp, which is the natural guitar key, Barry could play that key really well up there. He had F sharps for days, G sharps, F sharps, right? My good note was the F concert, the G right above that. So all the stuff in F, I'd play all the high G's all night. Barry would cover all the F sharps and stuff. And, you know, and he'd play one of the solo pieces. I did Greg's solo flugelhorn thing on So Very Hard to Go. Barry did the solo on Squib Cakes. So we managed to divide up enough of the pain, so to speak, to where nobody got killed. We were able to keep our chops up and do these tours. And because that's a really grueling schedule. It's a young man's sport, you know, to go out there and do that kind of touring, man.
How old were you when you were Tower? If you don't mind me asking. Like, what
in 1994, I was 34 years old when I got the gig, and I was with him for 6 years, and I left the band in 2000, May of 2000. Wow. So I just turned 40. And 6 years, you know, 4 albums, 6 world tours, 2 concert DVDs. And also they brought me back for the 40th anniversary DVD.
Yeah.
And Emilio was gracious enough to give me a solo on that. And he basically, you know, Mimi and I have always gotten along really well. And he told me, you know, when in the beginning, he says, Church, you can play anything you want on this. You can play as much of our, but it's going to be a long set. It's going to be 25 songs because we're going all the way through the songbook and we're playing all this stuff with Sam Moore, and we're doing all this other stuff. It was at the Fillmore over 2 nights. And then we had, it was all Fillmore, 2 nights at the Fillmore. And he says, so you can play as much or as little as you want. So I basically, because Lee Thornburg couldn't be there. Lee was out with, I can't remember. I think he might've been doing the Tonight Show at that time.
Yeah.
Either that, or he was out with Joe Bonamassa or another Super Tramp or one of those are. Yeah. So Lee couldn't make that thing. So I told, since Michael had not played any of the Monster with the Lee stuff, and that's the stuff that we played heavily when I first started with the band, because that's the record we were touring on.
Right.
Right. So I said, well, Mike, why don't you take a little break on this stuff? Because you have a whole lot of stuff to play.
Yeah.
I said, I'll play the Monster and the Lee stuff, and then I'll play this and that and that and this. And Mick was there. And so I pieced together enough of a performance where I covered a lot of the stuff. And so I knew I would still have a little gas left over for the solo at the end, because I knew the solo was going to be a bear. And I knew that we were going to do Knock Yourself Out at the end of the show, and everybody was going to kind of just improvise and play just crazy stuff at the end. And I wanted to make sure that I could last for the long haul, because that was basically a double Tower show over the course of 3 hours of music there, you know.
Oh, wow.
So it worked out great. And you know, but after 6 years, it's, you know, it takes up a large amount of your life to tour for 200 days a year and do 170, 180 shows a year. That's a lot, man. And you have to decide if you want to give up the things. I saw so many cats out there, and I toured for many years after I worked with Tower, but I saw so many guys, you know, miss important things in their children's lives and the lives of their family because they were out on the road, man. I see guys crying into their phone because they missed the first time their brand new kid said daddy. Or they didn't get to see the first steps of their daughter. Or they weren't there when their mother passed away. They were somewhere in Eastern Europe and couldn't get back for the, you know, we make a lot of sacrifices to be touring musicians. Everybody thinks it's glamour and it's glitz and it's great and all that stuff. And musically it is, you know, when you're playing with a great band, musically, that's the highlight of your life. 2 hours a night, man, you're on fire. One of the best bands on the planet.
Right.
The other 22 hours though, you're still having to deal with life. You're still having to deal with keeping your family together, keeping your bills paid. You know, a lot of responsibility. Yeah. And when you add the stress of travel with the stress of work, you know, it's not for everybody. It's tough stuff, man. And, you know, and it takes a certain kind of individual to be, not only do you have to play at a very high musical ability to be able to do that, but you got to have your stuff together, man. Cause if you get sick out there on one of those tours, you're stuck. And what are you going to do? Go to a hospital in Poland?
So, Bill, can I ask you, here's the thing. I'm getting, you know, I don't know if you said, but I'm getting IMs through Facebook.
Cool.
Bill, can I take questions? Bill, would you be willing to come back
Yeah, sure, man. Sure.
Would you be willing to, I mean, just like your career is just so amazing. And we just touched on just like that much of it, you know? And but I got people that really want to ask some questions. So
yeah, but we got a couple minutes here. Fire up a couple more questions. Yeah, and I'll keep it short.
Would you be willing to come back though?
And, sure, absolutely.
Okay, awesome. So, yeah. So the first question is, okay, this is from John. Oh, my buddy John out in New York City. Hey, John, how's it going, bud? Hey, Bill, what did Tower Power teach you? What did that gig teach you as a player, and how did it make you a better player?
Well, they had a huge body of music already recorded by the time I worked with them, you know. Oh. And I was fortunate; I got to work with a lot of different trumpet players of that band. I got to work with Mick. I got to work with Greg Lee. Jesse McGuire, great trumpet player.
Oh, that, yeah. Jesse's a huge player.
Jesse's a great player, man. I never saw a cat get so many standing ovations playing a solo with the band, trumpet player, than Jesse.
It's amazing, man.
Every night, standing ovation, every night. And that cat just brought it every night. Don Harris, another great trumpet player. Dom was on the band for a while. I worked with Mike Bogart when Mike's first got on the band. So I got to work with a whole bunch of different players. So I got to see how all these different players and also the master Mick approached.
Yeah.
The way they played this music. So that gave me a different perspective. I learned a lot about endurance because you got to produce every night, man. And if you fold halfway through the night, you don't last on that band because they don't suffer fools, man. So I learned how to pace myself to make it through a 2-hour show and still be able to be burning just as hard at the end as I was at the beginning. You know, I learned a lot about playing with a very tight rhythm section.
Yeah.
I learned a lot about playing with a very tight horn section. Like I said before, articulation, phrasing, feel, soul, musicality, dynamics, all the elements of playing at a very high level. That horn section swelled together. We decrescendoed together. We did our falls precisely together. We did our attacks precisely together. We did, you know, played precisely together all the time. And, you know, you have to feel that music.
Yeah.
You have to feel where the center of the beat for the center of the groove is. That's groove music. If you don't feel that groove, you're not going to be able to play that music, you know? And in the very beginning, you know, when I was hanging with Barry, I was like, man, I'm having trouble feeling this one song. I don't remember the song. And I'm saying, you know, man, you know, what's going on here? I'm not feeling this like I should. And Barry, you know, gave me a beautiful piece of advice. He's been working with Eddie Palmieri and all these great Latin bands. He goes, man, you got to feel the clave. And I was like, really? He says, yeah, man, funk music has got a clave, just like Latin music has. And I was like, no, you know? Just think about soul vaccination. Da, ba da ba da ba ba da. 2-3 clave.
That's like, right. That's
ding. I went, oh, wow. It's so approaching that type of music, that type of funk, and a lot of even the James Brown kind of funk.
Yeah.
It's the phrasing and the style and the way the percussive attacks and the way you aggressively attack that kind of music when you perform it at a high level, it's more akin to Latin music than it is to jazz music or big band music or anything else, man. So once you make that Latin connection, bam, it just started flowing there, you know, and playing in tune, you know, that band plays good pitch, man. You got to make sure your pitch is on because a lot of times it's being recorded. And if you're the one that ain't playing in tune, it's a real obvious, it's super obvious.
All right, I got another question. This is from my buddy Matt in Texas. Matt.
Hey, Matt. Cool, man.
Matt says, Bill, what was it like going from a hard-hitting band from Tower Power to sitting in the LA studios and having to be precise and play pianissimo on the drop of a dime and being perfect every night or all the time every time you sit down?
That's a whole different game, man. It goes back to, you know, I had a little bit of time when I stopped touring with Tower. I had to kind of basically reinvent myself.
Oh.
And when I came back to town, and it wasn't, I had about, you know, that was mid-2000. When I started doing a lot of film work in LA, it was the following year around 2001. So I had about 6 to 8 months to assess my chops. And I knew that I had road chops, and I knew that I could play anything high, fast, and loud, you know. But, you know, we talk about pedagogy. We talk about going back to the basics of playing the instrument. Every day, basics of playing the instrument. Jimmy Stamp, mouthpiece buzzing. Stamp, Clark, Arbenz. You know, I got back to the basics every day, and I started realizing that the guys that were working in that world were mostly orchestral cats. They're guys that came out of conservatories. They're guys that that had gone to SC, UCLA, you know, Cal Arts, really good reputable schools with world-class orchestras. And I realized that to survive in a that type of environment, you know, was a whole different sound. The first major film I got called to work on was Swordfish with Halle Berry and John Travolta.
My favorite movies, by the way.
John Cheadle. And yeah. I got called for that because I knew one of the orchestrators that was working on the film with Christopher Young, the great composer. And they were looking for I'm looking at the clock up here to make sure I don't go over too
much. You're good.
Okay. This I knew this was going to be an interesting film because my friend called me out of the blue and said, hey, we're working on a film. I'm working with a composer. I can't tell you his name right now, but he's looking for some electric trumpet sounds. Who do you know that has done records of electrified trumpet? And I said, well, check out Miles Electric Period. I gave him a couple of Miles's records. And I said, check out Randy Brecker. Randy did some great stuff with, you know, Don Ellis. And I named off the three or four guys I know that were doing a lot of electrified trumpet work, you know. And I didn't think much of it. I did the guy a favor. And, you know, two or three days later, my phone rings and says, hey, man, this is Garinot, the guy that's doing the orchestration. He goes, this composer I'm working for is Christopher Young. And I said, oh, okay. He goes, well, he would really like it if you would prepare him something out of your studio for what your concept of these sounds are. So I took just a few little licks, little melodic kind of licks in my home studio, and I ran them through a lot of these filters and just created all these wow flangers and comb filters and all these crazy filters I had and plugins. And I put it on a CD and sent it, you know. And so about a day or two later, my friend Garinot calls me back again and says, hey, Chris would like you to come to his studio in West LA and bring your horn and bring a bunch of mutes. And we're going to try to figure out what he's sound wise, what he's looking for. So I went and met with Chris, and Garinot was there in his studio and his crew and a lot of his orchestrators. And we came up with a concept for the sound of John Travolta's character. And he wanted something kind of like Electric Miles with the mute. He liked the Harmon mute. I brought every mute I owned, man. I'm like, this cat wants to hear a mute. I've got it in this. I had a bag of mutes bigger than my bag of horns, right? He finally hit upon, you find it up here. Because after this film, I thought about having it gold plated because it's kind of my favorite mute now. It's a Joe Rawl, but it's copper. Yeah. And at that time, you know, it was a little brighter. But, you know, he liked the sound of this mute, you know? So I was like, oh, cool. So I used the mute. We recorded a few things. He showed me the main title theme of the thing, and it was just a couple of little riffs. And he says, for the whole rest of the film, I want you just to improvise everything. I'm like, yeah. I don't even want to write anything for me. He goes, no, it's going to be all improvised. He says, you'll hear the orchestra. We'll give you charts, but it's just going to have bar. I wish I could pull them out right now. It's just basically bars marked off with slashes through them. No chords, no nothing. With an arrow that says, play here. No indication of key, no indication of chord structure or anything. So as we're working with this, I'm like, well, I'm going to need to know some chords. I said, do you want to go atonal? He goes, I want it to be atonal. I want it to be so far outside. Don't come anywhere near the key. Drift over time. Don't allow time to affect you. So I was like, dude, this is right up my alley because I'm a jazz player, right? I could play this stuff all day long. So I'm thinking Electric Miles, you know, Electric Randy, whatever. Record come to the session, you know, we get in there, 110 piece orchestra in Eastwood scoring stage at Warner Brothers, and they got me in my own. First of all, I walk in with all my stuff and I'm starting to walk back toward the trumpet section, and I see Malcolm McNabb back there, one of my all-time favorite trumpet players, and I see John Lewis, and I see David Washburn, and I see Warren Lunick, and I'm going, oh man, I'm walking back there because I think I'm going to be in the section. And the guy runs out, one of the studio seconds runs out of the studio and goes, no, Bill, you're in here. And he pulls me in front of all these guys, pulls me over and puts me in one of the premiere booths right next to the main recording room, and also the control room booth. There was a side artist booth there, and then everybody else was in the large studio. So right in front of all my heroes, I get pulled into the rock star booth. I got a C24 stereo mic in there that costs more than my car. I got all my effects and all my digital effects and all the rack of stuff that I was using at the time. And I get to sit in there and play rock star and play over this incredible orchestra in the other room, playing all this amazing stuff, you know? And so we recorded that over the course of 2 weeks, and you know, the film didn't come out for probably 6 or 8 months later, but you know, that's still one of my, that's my first big film. And I went on to do a lot of movies with Chris yeah. Young and Danny Elfman and all the Spider-Man films back in the 2000s. So it was about a good 10-year run there. And then, you know, the industry, like everything else, the industry changed, and a lot of the composers that I worked with started going overseas for budgetary reasons and things like that. So that's a whole nother clinic.
And yeah, like I said, man, we could talk for years. I got a couple more questions if you don't mind. So Bill, here's another question. This is from my buddy, Jeff. Bill, what? Okay. Let me just, okay. All right, Jeff, what are you trying to say here? Okay. Bill, what's the hardest book you ever played and why?
Wow. Well, the Tower book was definitely hard. That was a bear. The Blood, Sweat, and Tears book is pretty darn hard too. And in a way, you know, the band changed musical directors a few times. Back when I first started with them, Steve Jankowski was the musical director. Steve played second trumpet, great arranger. He was arranging a lot of their stuff. And the style that they were playing at the time was more geared to the original style of Blood, Sweat, and Tears, which was long ballads, not ballads, but long songs with progressive solos and things like that. It wasn't a super exciting thing because at that point when they were working in the 60s and 70s, Woodstock on, their music was great. You know, you had Spinning Wheel, you had the hits and stuff, but it wasn't like a da-da-da-da-da-da Broadway kind of show, man. It was cats taking long solos and developing solos and all these kind of things, you know. As the band changed through a few of the music directors, my friend Carl Fisher came on, great trumpet player, plays with Billy Joel. Carl rewrote a lot of the book to take advantage of Carl's range, and Carl's got an incredible range. That cat plays some incredible high notes, and he's got really good endurance, man. So the book kind of changed after Carl got done working with it. And I would sub for Carl. I would come out and play with Carl on some things, but usually I'd be subbing for Carl because I wanted to be the sub. I didn't want to be the regular guy because I didn't have the time to do all the little music festivals in middle America. Then now Brad Mason's musical director. Now Brad's a great trumpet player out of London, but I think he lives in New York. And Brad's been on I think he's been MD now for about 4 or 5 years with the band. But he kept a lot of the stuff that Carl Fisher had done. So that band, you know, that book has turned from something that was, you know, not that difficult. It was something you could stretch out on and relax. And there was different stages of the book where you'd have a little time to rest here and there. It through all this evolving of the book into more of a show type show, it turned into more of a chop festival. And the first tune right out of the bag was first right out of the gate was Lucretia McEvil, and they wanted to put a trumpet battle at the end of Lucretia McEvil, and the first song out of the gate, and I'm thinking, wow, man, that's, you know, how much fuel do I want to burn on this song, because I know that Spinning Wheel is coming an hour and a half down the list here.
Exactly. It's
just like You're Still a Young Man is coming at the end of the Tower show. I know I've got Spinning Wheel to play down here. And I know that no matter what I play between here and there, I better make that high G at the end of Spinning Wheel.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm thinking all that going, man, this is, you know, the book had changed so much that it had turned into much more of a blow. That's a tough book now. It's a great band. Those guys play their tails off. And they tour all over the world, but that's a hard book. Tower book was definitely hard. Tom Jones book was hard because it had a lot of precise playing in it.
Yeah.
plus, you know, when I went out, it was I'm trying to think. Pete Olstead, Pete, great lead trumpet player.
Oh yeah, Pete's amazing.
Played with Woody Herman, double C guy, just a beast on the horn. Yeah. Pete had rewritten a lot of the book to showcase his range, you know. So when Pete finally left the band, and I got a call from the musical director through a couple of friends, Herman Matthews, my friend, the drummer, you know, I got the call, hey man, we want you to come out and play on Pete's leaving the band. We want you to come work with Tom Jones.
Yeah.
First thing I told him, you know, Brian Monroney, the music director, I said, Brian, I said, I can't do what Pete did. I'm not that kind of player. I don't, you know. He goes, well, you know, we're thinking of going a little different direction. You know, we don't want you to play like what Pete did. We want you to do what you do.
Yeah.
And I said, man, that's what I want to hear.
Yeah,
that sounds good. So I went out there and I was kind of the de facto, musical director of the horn section at the time, because I was the first trumpet player. So what I did is I went through Tom's entire catalog, the stuff we were playing, and I said, guys, you know, I was listening to all the O Show tapes. I was watching the videos and stuff. Pete played great. The band was great. Horn section was great. I said, guys, let's rethink this a little bit, man. Tom Jones's career has been over the course of the last 50 years.
Yeah.
His music sounded different in 1960 than it did in 70, 80. He's had a hit in every decade, right? Yeah. I said, why don't we change the sound of the horn section, the way we play this stuff, instead of playing it all the same, why don't we play the style of that particular decade that this song was a hit in?
Yeah.
And everybody was like, cool. So I changed a little bit of the, I didn't, you know, I still had to play the double A flats all over Delilah, you know.
Yeah.
It had to be there, you know.
Yeah.
You know. Well, we had a bunch of those, you know. Yeah. I had to play the double A flats, which you had to lay for that every night, you know.
Yeah.
But there was enough rest in between that show where it wasn't a bloodbath like some of these other things. It was a good band. Plus, it's great working for a singer like Tom. Because great singers, they don't do 9-10 shows a week. Those cats do 4 shows, maybe 5 shows. And that's rare with big singers because they have to have vocal rest, right? So you go out on tour with one of those guys, you're not going to be playing every night. You're going to have a little time off. Anyway.
So I got, that's okay. This is, yeah, I'm, man, soaking all this up, man. I'm sure everybody at home and listening is soaking all.
I don't know who all's out there, man, but thanks for showing up. I hope I'm not embarrassing myself.
No, you're, thank you for sharing this. I got a question from David.
Yeah. Hey, David.
David's asking me, can you ask Bill, what is it like? How does he survive in an environment like Los Angeles?
Well, you know, that's a good thing, man. It's a very high cost of living area. You know, it takes a lot to, you know, and I lived out here for over 20 years before I could actually afford to buy a house.
Yeah.
Because the market had finally dipped enough to where I could afford to jump in the housing market, and rental properties are expensive out here too. And it's unfortunate because especially since 2008, 2009, when the economy really went to a dump at the end of that big housing bubble crash, I've seen a lot of younger players and a lot of players that come out here stick around for a couple of years and split, and a lot of really good players taking off and going back to Florida, going to New York, you know, the outskirts of New York, Boston, even back to Canada, because it is expensive to live out here. You know, you have to be very resourceful. You have to wear a lot of different hats. If I tried to just make a living as a trumpet player, I probably wouldn't be able to make a living just playing the trumpet. There's probably 3 of those guys in town that make a living just playing the trumpet.
Wow.
I also teach. I also, I'm an arranger. I'm a note of the ranger. I've arranged on Grammy Award winning albums. That has saved me a lot. I charge more for my arranging on a record than I do for my playing on a record, you know? So that's helped a lot. Also, I'm a songwriter and composer. I've got a catalog of ASCAP music I wrote. A lot of it I wrote during the Lopez Tonight Show. And a lot of the cues I wrote for that, a lot of the cues I wrote with Brian Maroney, the musical director of Tom Jones. We have a couple of catalogs of music out there that we placed on shows like TMZ and things like that. These little ditty, crazy little pieces of music that transition from one scene to the other. There's a lot of that stuff. That seems to be the new market for musicians. Guys, you know, are working more toward building a library of their own songs that they create so that this music can then be licensed to television, film, commercials, things like this. Unfortunately, a lot of the guys that do that work now, far too much of their music gets licensed to like YouTube videos and things like this. And if you get your song that you worked hard and paid all these musicians to record licensed to a YouTube video, you're not going to make any money on that.
No, you're not.
If it gets on a show like Bosch, you're going to make some money from that, but that's still cable. It has to land on a terrestrial ABC, NBC network and be shown over the airways before you're going to make any real money as a composer on anything like that, you know, if you're writing for television, you know. Writing for film's different. If you place a song in a major motion picture, basically you can negotiate your deal there, you know. But you have to know the music supervisor. It's just like getting known as a horn player, getting known as a composer. You got to know the music supervisor. You got to know the people that control the levers of power in that world. And you have to, you know, it always helps if your brother's a movie producer. You know? For the rest of us, you know, we're out here trying to scratch our lip. So yes, it's difficult. And you know, sometimes you wonder, you know, especially right now during this coronavirus thing, we're all, music production is gone right now.
Yeah.
I record a little bit in my studio for this project or that project. Yeah. But it's nothing like it was, you know. Live music's pretty much dead on the West Coast and most of the country right now, until we get a handle on what's going on with this thing, you know. So what you do is you do enough other things. I wear enough different hats between producer, engineer, I'm an audio engineer, recording engineer, trumpet player, arranger. I play trombone. I play other brass. I write for horn sections. I arrange all kinds of stuff. You do enough of that stuff, and you just have to have faith that it's going to work out. At the end of the year, you pull all your records up and pull out your your software, and you look and see what all the money you made or you didn't make.
Yeah.
Well, I guess I had a pretty good year because it all adds up. But it's tough for people that are used to having a day job and punching a clock and knowing that check's going to be there every 2 weeks. You've got to kind of abandon that philosophy and approach the gig economy more. You got to think more like, okay, I work with this casual office, that casual office. That means I've got 20 of my Saturdays booked for the last half of the year with private parties, corporates. I got this corporate account over here. I'm going to work with this corporate band, do a couple hits in Vegas. Probably going to make 10 grand within this year, you know, and you just piece it all together as you go. And, you know, right before this coronavirus thing hit, I was really starting to get in touch, you know, with, I was starting to branch out to a whole new group of producers.
All right.
I became aware of what I do. And I'm basically a one-stop shop. You know, if they have a record they're producing or whatever, and they want to add horns, they know that they can call me. They can send the stuff over here. I'll arrange it for them. I'll hire the horn players, the right horn players, to play the stuff. I'll show up at a studio of their choosing if they want to pay the studio. If not, I can do it here. I'll run the session. I'll produce the session. I will make sure the payroll works out with everybody. And basically, it's a one call finagle, man. They sign a check, they call me, and it gets done. And that's the kind of deal I like, because I can charge a premium for my services. I can charge a production fees. I can charge fees for my arranging. I can charge fees to play. And since I'm arranging it, I know how to write for myself when I play. I learned many years ago when I used to overwrite. I'd go, oh, this is going to be so cool. I'd get on the session, and I couldn't play it. So I learned that lesson really quick. Never overwrite your ability to play it. But also, I've been working with the same horn players in my production group for a long time, and I know their capabilities. I know how to write for them, arrangement-wise. And I have a different horn section for pop music than I would put together for jazz, and a different horn section for jazz than I would put together for, say, a ska piece or a pop piece. I have different players that can play different styles, so I know who to call for to plug in all these different players. So yeah, it is, you know, you have to just have the confidence that you're gonna be okay. It helps if your wife's got a good job, you know. And I got a good friend, a world-renowned percussionist. His wife's an attorney, and he can do whatever he wants.
Yeah.
He's like, he's always hanging out. He's driving him and say, yeah, it's great. My wife's an attorney. I'm like, you lucky dog. You don't ever lose her, you know.
That's right.
Piss him off, you divorce her, she's going to take you to the cleaners, right? But anyway, you know, it's, you know, you do all the gigs you can. You plug yourself into as many lucrative situations as you can. And then you hope it all comes together. At the end of the year, you go back and look at it and you go, hey, it wasn't too bad a year. You
know? Yeah. I got two more questions, but I can pick up your time, buddy.
I got all the time, man. It's what am I going to do? It's if the world's closed down, right?
I got two questions. And this is Bill, what equipment do you play on?
Let's see. My main trumpet is the new Bach commercial.
Okay.
And I had a little bit of a hand in designing this horn. They debuted it. They had prototypes that, well, this is back. Let me try to get my timeline together. It's probably been about 5 or 6 years ago. Rich Witzel, the trumpet.
Yeah, I know Rich. Yeah.
Yeah, Rich. He's the Northwest Bach guy. I don't know his exact title, but he's a good friend of mine. Great trumpet player. And I would always, you know, I go to NAMM show every year. I know all the Bach people. And Ted Wagoner was still working for the company. He was still Brass Product Group manager, right? And we were there 1 year, and I'm talking to Ted, and Rich is there. I'm like, guys, man, I said, you really need to, all these LA, you know, the LA sound is not a big, heavy Germanic trumpet sound. It's a lighter sound. All your competition is designing really lightweight horns right now. Maybe you guys should consider, I know you have the lightweight Stradivarius, but maybe you guys could, should consider a commercial lightweight horn. You know,
when,
me and Tristan Esco and a bunch of other players in LA, we're all, you know, talking, hey man. So the following year, Ted Wagoner shows up, Rich Witzel's there. They, you know, I go back there and they go, hey, we want to show you something. I walk back there and they had a couple prototypes. They had a, they had a medium bore and they had a large bore. And I've been moving more toward medium bore equipment because as we age, we don't have the physical strength that we had when we were younger.
You know? Right.
And I studied with the great Bob Finley, Chuck's brother. And Bob was like, man, you know, as you age, we move toward more efficient playing and more efficient equipment because we don't have the brute strength we had as a kid. So I played on the, I've been playing all the horns of the NAMM that day. So I'm standing, this was like back in one of the rooms. So I picked up the prototype B flat horn, the medium bore he had, and I put a mouthpiece in it and I started playing it. And man, this thing played like a house on fire.
Yeah.
Right. I see Rich's eyes are getting big. I was with Chris Sedesco. Chris was like, Ted's just sitting there with this big smile, you know, and I'm looking at the horn, and this particular horn, it doesn't have any of the Bach jewelry on it. It doesn't have the double brace here. It doesn't have the little knobs and all the curls and the protected this and that. It doesn't have any. So I told Ted and Rich right there, I said, guys, I said, this horn is amazing, just like it is.
Yeah.
I said, don't put the little thing at the bottom there with the screws. I said, don't put any of the Bach jewelry on this horn. Keep this a stripped down. Think of this as a Indy car in the 500 instead of the Buick or the Cadillac cruising down, you know. And I'll be darned if they didn't listen. I'm so happy that they listened.
Yeah.
And I was probably not the only one telling them this, but it seemed like I was kind of confirming that some other players, you know, I know that Charlie Davis had a part in it Gary Grant was involved. You know, there was a lot of great players that had a lot of input on this horn.
I interviewed Walt Johnson earlier. And he plays one of those.
Yeah. Walt played Colicchios for years, man. When we used to play in the Raider band, he was playing the Colicchio trumpets. And man, you know, if he's playing them, it's just a great horn. I've kind of transitioned into more of a studio player than a live player because of all the reasons we talked about earlier, right? There's not a lot of tours left anymore where they're hiring first rate players to go out on tours.
Right.
Because of technology. Now everybody's running tracks, not Blood, Sweat and Tears, not Tower, but most of your pop acts now, they're all running tracks.
Right.
So they don't have to pay world-class players to go out and do their tours. They can pay players that look cute on camera and can jump around and are able to dance and have movement and look good and young and can flip a horn around. You know, everything's pre-recorded, and I worked on a lot of the recordings, so I know a lot of it's pre-recorded. So there's not that demand for top flight players on the touring scene anymore, right? So they can hire these younger players that are not as good of players, but they're dancers and they have their own, you know, they do all their own stuff, and they can pay them a lot less dough. You know, that looks better on the bottom line, looks better to the management company. You know.
And what mouthpiece do you play on?
I've got a few, you know, I don't have as many as some of my friends.
Exactly. Yeah.
I've got a couple of different setups. It depends. Being a studio guy, you have to be able to get different sounds.
Yeah.
Most of the stuff I get called to play is more commercial lead, power classical, we call it.
Right.
Like the Monday Night Football thing. That's we call that power classical. Where you're playing classical kind of stuff, but you're putting a lot of sizzle on it, and it's real bright and big, you know. So that's power classical. I like KO stuff at Stombe USA. I like the Flex stuff.
Yeah, KO.
I've got a 3F of his I use to you know, sometimes I got a 7F. I've kind of been moving toward a little bit different cup size. That's basically for most of the practicing and most of the pretty sounding stuff, classical kind of solos, or if I'm sitting in a section, probably that 3F or a real Bach 3C and I got everything cut for sleeves. I use Reeves sleeves, and I use also the Stombie flex sleeves are quite good because every horn has a little different gap, has a little different annulus. I have C trumpets. I got three or four B flat trumpets, cornets, piccolos. You know, I got a whole gaggle of horns here. On a film date or on a date where you got to play a lot of different styles, you got to bring four or five different horns because if you've got a guy sitting there that predominantly an orchestral guy that's playing a C trumpet, you better pull your C out so you can match his sound.
Right.
I'll pull the C out on something like that. I got a Fred Powell customized C that Fred made for me. Great trumpet builder, great trumpet player.
Yeah.
So on that, I'd use a little different setup. I like the Hammond mouthpieces. Fred suggested I check out the Hammond mouthpieces for C trumpet, for that particular trumpet, because the gap in the annulus on that. I've got a Stombie four valve piccolo that I like a lot. One of the Master series. Mm-hmm. And I've done a little work on that. Got an old Mount Vernon Bach that I use sometimes if I get called to play like a session for a TV show, something that's real period, and they want it to sound like it was recorded in the 40s. I've got the right mic set up for that. I'll use an older horn just so it's kind of has that funky sound on it, you know, because this horn's great. It's one of the most versatile horns I've ever played. I can play studio lead on it. I can play classical on it, but it has a real clear piercing sound. It has a clear sound. And sometimes you don't want a clear piercing trumpet sound. You want a real kind of a fuzzy Chet Baker cross with, you know, you want something different. Now you can do that with a microphone. You can do that with effects, with EQs and things like that. But I'm a big fan of trying to get the sound from the horn. Like I got called to play on the Netflix series, Money Heist.
Yeah.
Right? Everybody knows that's one of the most popular Netflix shows in Europe. And they were re-recording an old French song, an old Italian song, and they wanted it to sound like a period. They wanted it to sound like an old French, you know, old Italian brass band. So I've got an old cornet here that I've got, an old LeBlanc cornet that was built in the 60s, Alhurt model. Yeah. So I brought that, and I have brought three or four different horns, the producer standard, Samantha Powell, great producer. She's going, well, you know, let me hear what you got. And I put the regular trumpet out, and she was like, oh, okay. And I pulled that cornet out, and I played two notes. She goes, that's the sound I want.
Yeah.
So I used the old cornet. It sounded like it was recorded in the 40s. It was perfect for that piece. And it's just knowing what they want and knowing how to give it to them. That's
exactly
a big part of it, man.
So Bill, I'm just going to take a moment here to all of you who have been watching us again. Thank you so much. And I apologize because I got at least 40 questions for you, Bill.
And I kind of droned on at length about some of that stuff, and Bill, I apologize.
It was gold, Bill. It was absolutely gold. I'm sure everybody at home watching is you're like a living library. I mean,
I don't know about that, but
you know what I mean? You have this wealth of knowledge that is not around, or very few have it, you know.
Thank you.
And so I apologize. Bill, you will be back though, right?
Yeah, let me know when. Like I said, I'm doing a little bit of work these days. I've got some other things going on, but we'll find a day and we'll set it up and we'll take off. We'll take from where we took off here and we'll move forward, see what's going on. And I wish I knew what the future was. We will see what the future will have to be for live music and recording music.
But I got one more question for you.
Yeah, sure.
My buddy Sam, he's a band director.
Oh, cool. Hi, Sam.
And he just texted me and he says, can you ask Bill, how do I get young players to get their mental capacity right and their attitudes right when it comes to serious performing? How would you suggest, what would you tell if you're giving a masterclass and someone's I don't have the focus and I don't have the drive to really, you know, what would you recommend they do as far as getting their head right, far as top-notch performing every time?
Well, that's a really good question.
Yeah.
And my hat's off to band directors out there. That is a hard job. And I teach a little bit as a music mentor in a couple of the private schools here in Los Angeles. So I'm dealing with junior high and high school kids mainly. And I know how difficult it is to motivate, especially in today's technological times, because there's so many distractions.
Yeah.
Their iPad, their iPhone, Their heads are constantly in their phones. They have an attention span of a gnat. They're into, yeah, into instant gratification. Yeah. They're into pushing a button and having something happen. And the whole process of learning a musical instrument is the total antithesis of that type of mentality.
Right.
First thing I try to do is get them away from their technology, you know, get them. And then, you know, once you got the brain off the phone, all the phones go away, no phones in the class, you know. In one of the schools I teach at, they have a big audio visual setup behind me with a Mac computer, big 50, 60 inch screen. So I can project whatever I want up there.
Yeah.
So in the days that I'm going to be running an ensemble, these kids come in about 3:30 in the afternoon. I've already got YouTube open on that with Miles Davis or Herbie Hancock or some fantastic band playing the very song that they're going to be working on that day.
Okay.
So they walk in and immediately they're like, wow, what is that? You know, so that intrigues them. And they, and I said, oh, that's Woody Shaw playing. He's like, wow, that sounds great. I'm like, well, we're going to be working on that song. So look at this recording. You know, while they're putting their horns together, they got a recording there. They got something stimulating them, showing them what the highest level of performance is, you know. And sometimes that'll be enough to give a little bit of a transfer, you know. Then, you know, I'll pull up or I'll stop that. We'll work on the song for a while, and I'll have a couple of other versions of that song, maybe with Chick Corea playing the song, or maybe a whole different instrument playing the song. And I'll introduce that later on during the rehearsal and go, well, let's hear how Chick interpreted this song. Bam. And all of a sudden it starts, you see the light bulb starting to glow, that in different interpretations of this music means a whole different set of criteria here. You know, the hard thing about young people is keeping them engaged enough and keeping them inspired enough to where they don't just tune you out.
Yeah.
It's so simple for them to pick a phone up and, oh, they're in their game, you know?
Yeah.
And it's my hats are off to the educators out there, because I'm a product of a good school,
yeah,
band directors. I had great band directors.
Oh.
And that's probably, and I give them a lot of credit, and most of the credit from what I've been able to do in this industry was because I had great mentors and great band directors at really critical times in my musical development. You know?
Yeah. Well, Bill, and again, I thank everybody that stayed with us. And Bill, thank you so much for your time.
I mean, thank you, Joseph, man.
Like I said, you're one of the greats out there, man. And, you know, thank you for all you've done for us, you know, trumpet players,
cool, man.
Players coming up. Bill, we'll have you back part two.
Sure, that's cool, man. I'm checking out your mutes in the background back there. You got a Dennis Wick cup, I see. That's great. Yeah.
I come from the school that wherever I go, man, if I'm going on any session or anything like that, I have everything.
There you go, man.
Yeah.
Well, thanks again for the invite. And I know we got to cover a lot of stuff today. That's great. And I look forward to working with you on another one of these. This is a great service you're doing for people too, because the young players need to hear this stuff, man. It's not all about, you know, music is not a destination. Right. Music is a journey. It's a lifelong journey. You're never going to get to the point to where you've done it all and you don't need to practice anymore. And you know, that never happens. And the beautiful thing about it is we are so fortunate that we're able to interact with people on a level to where they're happy.
Yeah.
We deal with people when they're happy. We give them entertainment. We get energy from them. We give them energy back. The fact that we're entertainers is a great thing, because we deal with people at their happiest. I feel sorry for the people that have to deal with people at their worst, like police officers and first responders. And, you know, they're the real heroes out there, because they have to deal with people at their worst. We're lucky. We get to deal with people at their best. And that's an incredible blessing that we have as artists and musicians. And keep that in mind.
Well, Bill, like I said, we'll definitely have you back on a future webinar. And again, if any of you have any, here's the thing. If you have any questions for Bill, this is going to be posted on Facebook.
Cool.
We're Facebook Live. Bill, if we get more questions, if I could just redirect those questions to you and you can answer them on Facebook, is that cool?
Yeah, I could probably get to a few of them. I don't have a lot of time to sit down and get along. I'd much rather do it in an environment like this.
Yeah.
But I'll probably pick and choose if I see something that looks like it's something that I can help. You know, I'll throw down a little bit.
I appreciate that, Bill. And, cool. And thank you so much for your time. And guys, We'll see you on the next webinar. Sorry. Have a great Sunday, everybody.
Great.
Bill, thank you again, man.
Take care. Be safe.
All right, brother.
You guys be good. Thanks again.